So a big part of what's happening here is as I get the first batch of materials for this, what we can do is we get a lot of pre-cutting done. And cool, thanks. I'll just narrate the rest of the video, but
any more cuts for you today?
No, that'll be it.
Alright, we'll have a great day.
Yeah, so this is where we get good service at Home Depot on saws. They're going to cut straighter, more true, more precision than, you know, what you're likely to be able to do off-grid without the background noise. And I'm going to do this video in several sections, probably its own playlist. But on a portable building thing, once you kind of have a design thought out, and this is one where it's a little bit slow going because it's the first one, it's a prototype. I've got my... The framing lumber for the upper framing is 2x3 on this particular one because I'm trying to save weight. I'm using 2x6 on a lot of this. Now, the trick, though, in reducing waste is to, and also to get higher quality precision cuts, especially if a lot of the construction is going to be done off-grid, such as the case of this project. And as long as, you know, Home Depot is up and running, take advantage of it. What they generally do here is Home Depot is going to have this type of saw where you can cut linear lumber with good precision cuts. And then they have a panel saw for cutting the OSB. And nothing beats these for precision on the cuts, period. These are a very expensive saw. The saw itself isn't super complex or expensive. But this whole rack and power system for that whole thing, you're unlikely to be able to copy that level of precision at home. It's about a $4,000 or $5,000 saw, and what it allows you to do is to get pretty decent precision and good square cuts on your OSB so that it goes together with pretty good precision. And I use liquid nails and screws on the mobile application. So we'll be going into that more later. The other thing is, if you're doing this in any proximity to a Home Depot or a Lowe's or both, you can bounce between the two, get familiar with them both. You don't necessarily have to buy all of the materials at once, but you know, buy enough to get going and get moving with the project. So on shopping this stuff, Home Depot and Lowe's are probably going to be within a few bucks of each other. And one of the things I've noticed is with the veteran discount, the 10% veteran discount, Home Depot is not likely to give that to you unless you're disabled, they actually checked a card, or retired, or active duty military. I'm not disabled. I am honorably discharged from active duty. That's good enough to get the Lowe's discount. Home Depot will kind of fight you on that, on whether or not you're disabled or retired, unless there is a Lowe's right down the street that's willing to discount, and then you invoke the price matching. And the price matching is that if you can verify that the store down the street gives a certain level of discount or meets a certain price on certain lumber, the management actually have discretion on up to 30% of the pricing on the lumber. And so if you are, let's say you're willing to take damaged lumber, like this piece here, they have discretionary pricing on either damaged materials or price matching, but usually not both. It's something to consider when you're buying materials. So what's going on here? Building the framework of the building on the trailer. And the trailer is flat enough that I can use it as a layout table, even though it's tilted. It's a 10x5.5-ish, so we've got some overhang on both sides, but I've got this 2x6 stuff that acts as enough support to deal with that. And so we're supported in the middle, we're supported at the two ends, I put a little bit of support in the center, but I also have to watch out that I'm not attaching it anywhere in the center. I have screwed down these spacer blocks to prevent it from sliding around, and that is so that it doesn't just fall off going down the road. And they're screwed into the deck, okay? Yeah, I end up with some screw holes in the deck, no big deal. The value of the trailer versus the value of the decking and the frequency with which I expect to replace the decking throughout the life of the trailer, that's no big deal, okay? But the spacer blocks keep it from sliding around. They're screwed down, not nailed down. And then when I add a couple of sideways screws here, then it's relatively secure. I don't do that until I put the sheathing on and make sure that the corners on the sheathing are going to make this thing square. I'm also not using particularly thick material for that sheathing. The other thing is I'm going to be putting some bracing in here that's biased a little bit more to one side than the other so that this thing can be lifted and moved with a forklift. But that's, I may or may not do that because really plan A for this thing is that we jack it up a little bit, just unscrew the sides, jack it up a little bit, and then pull the trailer out from under it. That's really plan A for this thing. So I may or may not put the forklift braces in, but we'll see as this progresses more. So at this stage, we're just about to put the decking on. I've got reinforcement pieces here. That's because we're gonna be using some of the leftover wood. When I had the 4x8 lumber cut down to 6 feet for the width of this, then what we end up with is some 2 foot pieces. Well, that's where I end up with a 2 foot center on this because of the way the spacing works out on everything, with everything else being 16 inch center. So I put extra reinforcement in the middle, and that also helps reinforce what might normally be a weak spot on the building. But the sheathing that goes on later is also going to be adding a lot of strength. On this sort of a build, because this thing is small and it has to go down the road, it has to be more secure than something that's simply nailed together and left in the same spot forever. So we're gluing. Everything that involves sheathing gets glued. And when we sheathe this, there's kind of a smooth side and a waffle side. The waffle side is the side that gets the glue. I'm using tried and true liquid nails with the DeWalt glue gun. I've got kind of a love-hate relationship with that tool. It's a mess. It's the only one of its kind in the business. There's one from Ryobi, but it's not cost-effective to use the small tubes of glue that work with the Ryobi gun. So with this, you get three times the glue for barely twice the price of, let's say, one of the smaller tubes. The other thing is, it's not very fatiguing to use it. It just, it overrides the plunger every once in a while, and it gives you a real, I don't know if you can see that in there. You know, you have to, pretty much once you pop a tube, you got to use the whole thing. So, on a build like this, it becomes important. You are not wrong to do nails at this stage. I'm going to use screws because I bought a big container of screws. But if you have a nail gun, if you want to nail at this stage, you are not wrong to nail it. I know a lot of people are really firm on screws and glue only. And for the most part, that's true. One of the reasons I'm screwing instead of nailing is this is going to be in an area that has a lot of temperature fluctuations, and screws are less likely to come out than nails. Once that glue dries, I could even back all my screws out and use them in another part of the project. Once that glue dries, that's all really secure. But you've got to tighten it down in order for the glue to dry. The other thing to look out for at this stage, not to trap any leftover debris or tools underneath there as you screw down the panel. This also, I'm not going to be able to show it in the video, but this is also why I left a little bit of fudge factor in the spacing on some of this. If I need to square this, I'm going to be able to shove it square when the panel's up here by screwing a corner, kind of making sure everything's kind of shoved up square, and then screw another corner, and then just kind of follow the lines around. And my main purpose for this isn't necessarily the structural strength of the screws, but to make sure it tightens down really good so that that glue hardens tight, okay? So it doesn't glue harden soft or harden with a gap in between the two. And so there's really no such thing as too many screws on this. again, if you feel you're wasting a couple of bucks with the screws, once that glue hardens, you can back those screws out and use them in another stage of the project. And here, if you do not see glue squeezing out, you probably either didn't use enough glue or need to put another screw in. Let's say we've got a gap over here. If we don't have glue squeezing out, then we probably either needed more glue or need to put a screw in. Once you've put a piece on and put a screws in, it's too late to put more glue in. Okay, so when it's become too late to do that, you just have to note where that location was. Like over here, I didn't have enough glue on this rim, so it really didn't take. So when I screw this down, one, I'm going to go a little sideways to make sure I'm getting into that because I'm a little close to the edge where the spacing worked out. And so these screws are never going to get backed out. They're going to have to stay. And that's just reality, okay? So if you're going to do the glue and screw and try to recover some of the screws, realize, just take a mental note, there are going to be some spots where you don't want to recover those screws. This is where I'm going to cheat a little bit. Normally, at this stage, with a good solid deck on, the glue's curing, I'm sure it'll do just fine. Normally, at this stage, if it were a building, you would start putting your framing on, right? Framing your upper stuff. Okay, here's where I cheat, and this is why you can cheat on small structures that are using OSB or plywood sheathing. What I'm going to do, because I have this good 6-inch wide base now, is I'm going to attach the exterior sheathing first. It's going to be rigid enough that it gives me something to attach a framing to. So I'm going to get a little bit of help. We'll get a few screws on the side and attach the sheathing first, at least a little base layer of sheathing, and then the wall goes in later, immediately afterward. So after a good partial day of work, we've got more progress here. These corners get placed here at the bottom where I even everything up across the bottom, basically put one in, tilt it over, and put the other one in. And then as I can build a column on the deck, here's how it goes. It's 2 2x4s, although you could use a 4x4. It's cheaper for me to get 2 2x4s, laminate them together with glue, hold it with a screw, and technically I could take the screw out after the glue dries, but I'm not going to do it on this. And then the 2x3 gets attached to the side so it can become a base for attaching whatever interior siding I do. The other thing is that happens on that interior siding situation is that with base pieces secured down to the deck, glue and screws and secured to this, you can see the glue squeezing out, there's still not a lot that holds that wall. You see how we've got some wiggle here? You can see there's some movement there, right? A bit of flex, a bit of movement. And again, this thing's got to be able to go down the road and stay firm with at least, I would say a little bit of a partial load inside. So in order to stiffen this up, part of what we have to look at is how do we stiffen this dimension, this dimension between here and here? Well, once I have a base piece screwed down and glued, then what happens is if something attaches along here and at the bottom, you're trying to stretch wood if you flex it. You're trying to stretch and compress wood. And because this is all connected on the outside, we could push it to the outside, but if we're going to try to pull it to the inside, it still moves, but not as much. Over here, because as soon as I've got a sandwiched section that's glued and screwed and across the bottom with those bottom pieces, and this wall is only 2x3, then what happens, it's a lot stiffer. It's probably difficult to come through on a video how stiff it is, but it's definitely a lot stiffer and a lot secure. The other thing is, if it's going down the road, this isn't a trailer, but let's say we do take it to its destination partially loaded with stuff, we don't want that stuff to shift around and then blow out the side. So we want to have some little kick panel here. No reason to go all the way to the top with it and add weight, but once this is in its location, I'm probably going to add, let's say, a 6 or 8 inch strip of the wood across the top of here to stiffen up that section of the wall, and then probably it'll drywall with some kind of siding on top of it, although it may just remain as a wooden interior building once it goes in place. The corners, though, you gotta realize the corners get really secure on this. The whole body of it, because it's not fully supported on a foundation, I've just got some stiffening blocks down, but it goes with the theory of how this thing gets put in place. And the way that works is, with the trailer deck is very slightly smaller than the deck of the framework on the building. So right now, I simply place a couple of 2x3s, they screw into those massive corner pieces, and a few screws is what's going to keep this thing from tilting out of whack. You wouldn't use this as a full-on foundation, obviously, with a 2x3, but it's plenty for keeping this thing from tilting as I walk around on it. The other thing is, with this much weight on that trailer frame, even though it's all welded steel and it's pretty stiff, it was starting to flex on me, mainly because the frame of this kind of overhangs a little bit. And so for the remainder of construction, one of the other things to look out for is kind of lifting and shoving, and you shouldn't have to use a jack. You should be able to just kind of muscle it and shove it and then screw down the stand piece so that we're square with these pieces that I had cut at 3 feet. These were all cut at 3 feet, so I should be able to do a little bit of alignment here and look and make sure that we've got pretty straight and squareness, let's say with some of those lines on that OSB or something. You know, we've got pretty straight and squareness by playing around with the way these things, where we're going to attach the screws. Now, once we get to putting this into a foundation point, the corners become critical for the initial placement, and we actually do it the same way. We just do it with screwing some wood boards to the corners, but then once they're screwed in place and it's being held relatively securely, we pull the trailer out from under it. We would have to undo some screws, and we also have to, before we do that, we have to jack it up slightly to get it past our little 2x4 blocks that are all under there holding that onto the trailer. And when we jacked it up and kind of level it out, we'll have plenty of opportunities to re-level it as we lower it. And that's how that keeps going. Short version, what I have in place are some blocks just screwed to the corners, some 2x3s. All we're trying to do is keep this trailer from tilting as I walk around on it working, okay? That's all I'm trying to do, and it does need to be blocked front and rear. And then as it gets blocked, you want to level the trailer, the framework of the building. So it's just a matter of hand shoving. It's semi-flexible at this stage. There's no top, so it's semi-flexible at this stage. We kind of level this stuff out so that when we, as we keep going with the assembly, we're assembling it level. The deck of the trailer worked as a reasonably decent layout table up to this point, but as we start adding weight or walking around on a deck, we can screw that up. So we've got this sunlight panel. I haven't peeled the protective plastic off of it yet. I've just got that attached mainly so that I could check what my height is going to be on this side by putting a top board. Optimally, if I weren't really restricting myself to how I'm going to transport this thing, I'd like it to be a little taller. I'm going to be a little cramped for roof space in this, but this is really just the end section of a wider building. And so I knew that the ends of it were going to be, you know, they were going to have a low ceiling height on the inside. That's with me being over 6 feet tall. With shorter people, you're not going to have a problem with that. We've got the corners are compound with 2 2x4s, 1 2x3. That's also glued together. I'm going to be applying glue to two sides of this So that any place on this where the framing interacts with the sheathing, there's glue. Okay, so if framing touches sheathing, there's glue, and the glue goes on the waffly stuff here. You can apply it to the framing or you can apply it to the sheathing, doesn't really matter that much. But any place where framing interacts with sheathing, there's glue. And that's part of what's going to have this thing hold its shape and its structural integrity as it goes down the road. Once it's in place, maybe it doesn't matter that much, but the other thing I'm going to be looking at is, snow load and other issues, but we're not going to have as much roof slope as I would like to have to deal with serious snow load. So there's going to be some additional reinforcement to deal with that situation. We'll show that later on in the video series. The other thing we'll go over in another little snippet is wall stiffening. All right, so next thing here, we're getting more progress in between videos because I'm on kind of a schedule with this project. But what we're looking at here is I've got the front on, I've got some of these supports on. One of these, for I don't know if it's a warped board. I mean, it looked pretty straight to me, but it's sticking up at an angle, so I'm going to be tweaking it back, or maybe it unwarped itself overnight. I'm not quite sure. But I've got these up. Now, this wall in its entirety is not going to use very much glue because when this gets connected to the other half, then a lot of this wall is going to come out. So what will happen on that is I need to have a lot more reinforcement beam up here. And what I'm basically doing is making the equivalent of a glue lamp board, which is combines wood and OSB to make kind of a I-beam type construction. So I cut a piece of the OSB to be about the same width as the ends on this stuff. And I'm using that as, and because they had to be 10 feet long with a little overhang, I ended up with a split which is reinforced right here. And I'm using this as an alignment beam for everything here. Now, what you would say is, rightly so, there's not a lot of structural integrity to that. And there isn't until we start adding more compound and more wood to it. And as we do that, the added wood, like a top ridge piece that's gonna go on here, that gets glued in place. So it's a combination of screw and glue. You wouldn't be able to nail something like this and expect it to have any integrity at all. But screwing and gluing, and again, with 2x3 roof trusses, that's normally kind of weak. But we're going to be screwing long pieces to this. It's going to give it a lot more strength. And you also have to look at, in the RV industry, a lot of those roof things are, one, it's not a sloped roof. A lot of them are flat. Most of them are flat. And on a lot of cheaper travel trailers from the 60s to the 90s, a lot of those were using 2x2 framing to hold that roof on because it was just thin aluminum. And of course, as they age, they end up with snow load issues. So we're still going to end up with some enforced strength here. The other thing that gets a little dicey is figuring out the angles on everything. Now, because this is exactly 6 feet wide, and it has exactly a 2 foot rise as we go from this side over to that side, or right around a 2 foot rise, I figured out this was a 15 degree angle cut on all of this stuff. I wasn't quite sure what my rise was going to be on that because I was dealing with not quite knowing where I was going to end up with enough headroom in this thing. Obviously, there isn't going to be much headroom at this side. Okay, so there's going to be chairs and benches here, and as somebody sits down in front of this window for light, they're sitting in a chair that's at about the midpoint, and as they step back and stand up, there's enough headroom to deal with. So it's a very, very specific design situation I have to deal with, because one, I don't want this thing to be so tall it gives me a problem going down the road, and B, it's still got to be high enough inside to be a usable building. So when I was doing all that, I just built a lot of this stuff with overlap. See how a lot of these pieces overlapped? I've got a mark here that shows I wasn't quite sure what my extension was going to be down here. I built a lot of overlap. So a big part of this is, how do you deal with that? Trying to precision guess all of those angle measurements before you put everything up is going to lead to a shitload of frustration. Well, I'm cheating this, and that's also because this is a prototype and I'll be able to take measurements off of it to make the second one. But the way you deal with it, cheating it, is you just build everything long. You build everything sticking out a little bit until you're really sure of where your measurements are going to be. I'm probably going to pop this off to redo it. I didn't think I secured it. Maybe I did. But if I have to hit that, that's the only tricky cut I really have right now. Everything else that overlaps, I'm going to hit with the Sawzall. See, all that stuff that sticks over or overlaps or something like that, I hit with the Sawzall. And on this, I'm also cheating the off-grid situation. I could plug this into my trailer. I'm plugged into the wall because basically a convenience issue right now. But using a good full-power Sawzall with the Diablo blade on it means that I can get all this stuff off and start to get the roofing material on. Okay, so with the tops and tips trimmed off, we're ready to start putting some of these longboards. I sometimes lose track of the lumber terms on a lot of this. I don't know, batten or something like that. Also, you can see where one of these beams was actually made from a couple others. That was a miscut, but I decided that since that's the center and we're not super strong on this using 2x3s, I was going to triple that up and basically make a laminate beam out of that. That's part of what was going on there. The other part of it was I had to use that as a spacing guide for almost everything else. But with the roofing material that we're using, it comes under 8 feet. It comes in 79-inch lengths, which barely gets me long enough with very little overhang on everything to get down to our tips and still compensate for the angle here, okay? Kind of an odd thing that it's 79 inches, but it's going to work out really good with the angles that we're looking for. We just end up with very little overhang here. However, that's also helps me out as far as mounting a rain gutter here and recovering some water from the roof during a rainy season. My rain gutter is not going to be, you know, if it's nice to have a lot of roof overhang, I just didn't want the rain gutter to be blocking a lot of my sunlight either. So I just want to get the water off the sidewalls when I do all this. Okay, we don't really want the water coming directly down on the OSB, even if we end up using siding. We kind of want to keep water from getting directly on here. Like this conventional house here, you can see kind of some deterioration, water damage. And that's because this was built with no roof overhang on this. We look at this place, it's a much older house, and because they put a healthy amount of overhang, yeah, they've got a little bit of rot that was drifting back up there, but that rot never makes it into the structure of the house. I mean, at least not for over 100 years. And so they haven't really had the issues that this place has had, where it's been re-sided at least once and they've got, you know, little things going on here. So when we're building structures like this, also realize we can't do any roof overhang on the flat side that's going to get attached to something. But I can, if I'm going to leave it someplace for a while without attaching the other pieces to it, one of the things that I can do is I can get my little ridge cap and just stick it on there, and that gives me a little overhang for this side. Okay, so the top's trimmed down, our long boards going in here. This is what's actually going to support the roofing material. Now, normally you wouldn't be able to support that much roofing material with, it's not quite a 2 foot gap between the two, but it's close to it, right around 2 feet gap. And it would normally be more than 2 feet, it's just that these are 3.5 inch wide boards. So, or a true 4 inch basically, and or close to it. So anyway, it's roughly 24 inch spacing, which is within specification for this Ondura roofing material. The only thing that I'm running into with this stuff, it comes in 79-inch lengths, which is cutting it really close for this stuff. But the other thing is, again, a lot of the roof supports on this are 2x3, not super strong stuff, but it's plenty strong. It's a lot stronger than anything improvised. I was doing pull-ups on a center beam, or at least dead arm hangs, right? Okay, so, and it seemed to hold just fine. And that's with, you know, 2x3 here, but that's basically vertical column support. The other thing is, this stuff's ended up a lot stronger, is I compound more wood onto this location. Once there are two buildings attached to each other, that does even more to spread the load out and strengthen the piece. The other thing I will do as things progress is put a beam across the bottom, which again is going to do more to compound and make a more of a composite structure out of that edge. So we're going to keep going here. Got some of this stuff screwed down because what happened is I had to tweak this board back over a little bit to get everything to line up. And that's easy to do. You know, you just tweak it over a little bit. You can see where it started out, where some of the screw holes ended up. But where I'm also somehow, some way, slightly tapered at the top on this by about an inch. I think by the time I get the roofing material, everything else up, we're going to be just fine with that. When I put two building sections together, of course, I'll double check measurements. The first one becomes a prototype for each one after that. So I'm not going to copy the taper. But once I have an additional piece up to here, if we get a little gap somewhere, it's not perfectly matched up, there's ways to pinch it together with a vise or just using lag bolts. But after it's in, another layer of flooring goes in. So if there is a gap down here, which I think at that stage it's kind of unlikely, I still have the option of putting another layer of flooring in to deal with all that. And then cap pieces along where the seams are. Normal, common stuff in the mobile home industry or prefabricated building industry. All right, so as we're making more progress, I've got roof panels installed. I'm gonna go over to roofing in its own video to a degree, but we can see underneath, I've got some of this filler material. The rest of it, I use that filler material up here for when I build this in, and we still have to build in an enclosure here, and then I'm going to be insulating it. But I didn't have enough to do both the top and the bottom, and the top's really not going to stay a separate building permanently. So I'm just gonna, it's $15 for a package of that stuff, or $5 for a can of spray foam. Once I get close to done with this whole phase of everything, I'm just gonna go get a can of the spray foam and fill in a lot of these gaps. Because again, this all ends up indoors. Once the thing's built, there's another layer of roofing that extends all the way down to here. So the other thing is that this whole wall has to be removable, but again, it may sit a while before it's attached to the other half. And during that interim, I'm going to use this as a little bit of a storage shed. So the other thing is that either can happen or will happen, kind of to be determined situation on that later on, is when I put the other half on, I may still have a room divider situation, or I may build a larger center section so the other half doesn't connect directly to this. There's actually going to be a center section where the roof goes up more. And I want the option of putting a door here and deciding where a door is going to go on the halfway point. So I have a door that was salvage material. I think it's a narrow door. It's about a 26-inch wide door. I need to build a frame for it because all I have is the door. And so I'm going to have some leeway. I've got material for making a frame. But I wasn't quite sure whether I'm going to put it on the front half or the rear half or which way the orientation is going to be. So one of my filler pieces is going to be roughly the size and shape of that doorway. And when I do frame the doorway and just stick it up on here to take up space,
I can move it later on when I get this to its destination and make everything permanent. So the way this is going to work is I just build these sections. And with these filler sections coming in different widths, that really just depends on where things get filled in as we have these things up. But I generally want to keep them narrow so I have something to work with. Over here, something was out of torque when the top and the bottom got connected. So the top on that's wider than the bottom. It's going to give me some challenges when I attach another half to this. But again, that's what the trim pieces are for, to cover everything up. But I'm going to have to make a filler piece here that's either slightly tapered or just slap a board over it when I'm all done with the filler pieces. Over here, this is where I'm going to not make a filler piece. I'm going to put a doorway in, but if I need to move that doorway later on, I can, because I could move it either over here or over here by moving these little sections around. They just screw in. Now, as far as strength goes, normally you wouldn't be able to use what they call 1x2 structurally, although it is used in the RV industry. It's definitely used in the campers and the RVs. One of the ways that you can add to the strength rating when you're doing that is glue everything. So what's happening is these sections are not glued in place, but the rims are both screwed and glued on. Now, in theory, yeah, I could recover the screws, use them on other parts. 3 or 4 days from now, that glue is going to be fully cured and that section is going to be closed off. I'm never going to really see much incentive to thicken and insulate these, because I need to be able to get at these side screws and the bottom screws and all of that. The other thing is that if I'm going to take advantage of the trip to deliver this thing, and it's not super heavy, it's not killing the weight limit on the trailer frame that I have it on, I could put stuff in here to transport it. Well, at that stage, I gotta make sure I have some boards up here, at least temporarily screwed in place, that go the entire length of this wall, so that a load shifting situation doesn't just blow through the wall, because it's not as strong as, let's say, I would build this on a cargo trailer, and it's not as strong as what things are over here, because this wall's made to never go anywhere. Once this is attached, it's done. Bright and early, here is door detail for the rear doors. Now, for storage and transport, what I'm doing is I'm setting this up with a doorway that's going to get temporarily installed here. But I'm probably going to close it off. I'm not sure, but I was probably just going to put a board across here to close it off. As far as any of these gaps go, because this is the wall that basically gets removed upon arrival, I'm not going to go through the trouble to cut anything perfectly to fit this. I'm just going to slap something right over these gaps, screw it on, and that's that. These pieces cut to fit may end up in the final structure as room wall dividers. If I do that, once I would put them permanently in a spot, what I do, because I would have plywood on both sides, I may or may not drywall or put something on there, and I want the walls to end up at a relatively consistent thickness. I mean, it depends on what I do with this stuff. Then I would add another layer of plywood to this, and then that would become a pretty structurally sound wall. Even though the framing on the wall is only 1x2, the thing is the OSB is especially semi-structural. It would be a relatively secure wall. If I'm going to be using it as a door and movement, then what happens with this OSB is with movement you can kind of break up the particles. So generally speaking, for anything that's movement oriented, anything like that, you want to use plywood. The other thing I need to do is save weight on the overall structure. And OSB is definitely heavier than plywood. Plywood's a little lighter and stronger, but it's also about 30% more costly. 30 or 40% more costly. Basically, right now, late 2013, I'm paying 10 bucks a sheet, or a little under 10 bucks a sheet, close to 9 bucks a sheet for the OSB.
$14-$15 a sheet for plywood. So if it were less of an issue of money and more of an issue of weight, I would have been building all of this out of plywood. The thing is, it's not just an issue of money, it's also an issue of insulating factor and soundproofing and a lot of other things that are beneficial to having a building that's made with the OSB. For this rear doorway though, I want a double opening door so I can load a lot of other materials in here. And for the model of these buildings, I need to be able to not carry everything completely assembled. I need to carry part of it where just the materials are in here, we get it out, we pull the panels out, and we put up the rest of the building. So I have to have a large doorway, but that doorway probably will get just closed up, and one of the other panels that contains a door would end up being a doorway to the building. When we do that sort of thing, then we want to have lightweight doors, but you know, precision and beauty aren't really the issue, but function is. And so I cut these to the angle so I can maximize my door opening here. Eventually, when it get closed up, it would just be trimmed in. This area not having enough headroom to really put a conventional door in. So what I'm going to do here is I'm making it out of plywood with 1x2 framing on the door, a lot like you would make a conventional door. But I am making it double-sided. I'm going to be putting the other piece on the mirror side. This is an opportunity where you get to use some of the scrap wood that you have left over from other elements of the project. The other thing I'm doing is I'm going to trim it for neatness sake. I'm going to assemble it. I got to make sure there's no protrusions of screws out here, or nails if I were using a nail gun on this. Screws, it's a little more critical than nails. The nail gun nails are pretty soft metal, so if you hit those with a saw blade, especially the skinnier ones, it's not that big of a deal. You hit a framing nail with a saw blade, you're going to dull the blade pretty quickly. You hit screws with a saw blade, you'll pretty much ruin that saw blade. So what I do is I use some of the scrap wood here, and the more straight pieces in here, the more it stiffens this plywood. And what we try to do is we try to focus the warpage in opposite directions so it kind of forces everything back straight. And that reduces the warpage on the door. It's sometimes you get varying degrees of success for that, but it's screwed together, and as I tighten down the screws, there's generally less warpage. The other thing is, since these sections were cut out of the same sheet of plywood, it all would have warpage in one direction. Once that's flipped over mirror image, then we've got the two warpages working against each other that will hopefully make the door straighter than not. So this is the rear door section completed. The building's more or less complete at this stage as far as structurally. It's good enough to haul. I'm using it to store some materials that are getting hauled up to the same location. The general idea on something like this is do not stack anything above the windows. We've got to keep the center of gravity relatively low. That window line is about where we want to be. Now I've got these metal things on the side so that if a load shifting situation spreads the stress out. The wall sections, even though they were temporarily attached, were attached with screws, not nails. And there's other plywood slapped onto the outside of that, with that all secured so that we don't have a bowing issue on this wall. This one was so secure, I don't think we're ever going to run into an issue with that. But to keep the load relatively steady and secure, I'm throwing some other things in here just to keep it from shifting around. And then when it gets closed up, I just simply screw some boards onto the back. I mean, for somebody to undo a bunch of screws is about the same as popping a padlock. And so it's not super high security stuff. It's basically, this is going to serve as a basis for a very small but efficient off-grid workshop at a survival retreat location. The idea being that the mobile workshop is not very off-road capable. So I'm cleaning it out. I'm trying to go a little leaner and meaner. This thing was not happy on the highway. And so I don't know if it's the trailer, my truck, or a combination of the two. I've folded up the solar here, but obviously this thing provides enough power for me to produce these things anywhere. Okay, I could go anywhere and produce these things. Therefore, as an ongoing experiment is concerned, between the workshop trailer and, you know, any reasonable tow vehicle and a camper trailer, which, I mean, it still needs a little bit of work, but it's relatively okay inside. Between these, what we can do is we can help provide for somebody to be productive. Okay, now as far as making a living, that involves finding customers and clients and all those things. But with this, we can be productive. And that's going to be another video. But as far as the completion of this goes, it's movable. It's all screwed down to the trailer. We simply unscrew it at the destination. I use these boards as stabilizers so it doesn't tip back too much. I look at the floor level and the upper level. If this were flipped around, of course, we could probably use it as an entry porch in the camper trailer here, but I'm not likely to do that. I could build an entry porch for this a little bit cheaper than I can make another one of these, although, you know, same neighborhood. But that's part of my concept. I'm going to be showing to a few people as far as not just our off-grid construction, but our ability to do some business off-grid, especially if we find the right kind of investors, right people that want to be involved in building an actual survival community on a budget. With this workshop trailer, I'm thinking that we could produce 10 of these a week, and it wouldn't be out of line. It wouldn't be out of line to make 10 of these a week. Obviously, you're still paying for building materials, but it's not huge money. You know, you've got livable space. It's far, far superior to tents and improvised structures for really the cost of a couple of high-end tents, really, when you think about it. And it's at the point where if a group wants to regularly meet, let's say at somebody's farm or something like that, then you can place that infrastructure in the course of, let's say, a two-week summer type of thing, and it should work out. You know, it should work pretty well. So, we'll see what happens.